Okay, so that's the P5E3 Premium motherboard from ASUS, one of the best X48 overclocking motherboards for the 775 platform. If you have been following my legacy platform overclocking adventures, you may have seen me using this board quite a few times already. Incredible scores with the Core 2 Duo E6750, and now very recently the top score in W Prime 1024M with the Core 2 Duo E8500, a Wolfdale CPU. And some very good like air performance tests. I think memory was close to 2200 even on air, at least 2140, and with the 6750 was almost 2200, like 2170 something memories with 675 timings at very, very high FSB, like 680 plus or so. But anyways, the point of this video is to show you guys the PLL modification. So why would we have to modify the PLL voltage? Well, the default range for the CPU PLL voltage on these ASUS 775 motherboards is usually between 1.5 volts and 2.8 or 3 volts, depending on the CPU you install on the CPU socket. Usually it's 3 volts or 2.8. So the problem is not that we can't get it high enough, we cannot get it low enough. So with some 45 nanometer CPUs, mainly some Wolfdale CPUs, some, although it's not that common actually, some particular chips might benefit from a very low PLL voltage value, like 1.4 volts or 1.35. Usually it affects the maximum temperature the most. So it affects both the cold boot bug as well as the cold bug of the CPU we want to run on LN2. So usually if you start to raise the PLL a lot from the default of 1.5 volts, it starts to make the cold boot bug as well as the cold bug worse on many Wolfdale CPUs. Now, some particular Wolfdale chips might benefit a little bit from a lower PLL value, like 1.43, 1.4, 1.35. But in my testing, it's not actually that common. My second best E8500 actually liked lower PLL quite a lot, temperature-wise. So with standard PLL of 1.5, I could run the CPU, I think, -130. Max, then it would hit the cold bug temperature. But when I lowered the PLL to around like 1.4 or 1.38, but I think it was 1.4, I could go as cold as -170. And as you can imagine, it does help with the overall clock speeds in the end if you can get the CPU much colder. Now, the second thing it affects is the maximum FSB. Sometimes it might make the FSB, the maximum FSB, worse or better. But usually the only thing we want to reach with the lower PLL is the better maximum temperature. I think only Sam or Tapaka was able to find a CPU that could go to full pot temperatures with the PLL mode, like 1.36 volts or so. But anyways, so I just wanted to try the PLL modification with this particular motherboard model, but sadly this particular motherboard model seems to have some weird issues with Wolfdale CPUs in general, as I already expected in my W Prime video. So I'm still trying to investigate that thing. I think it could be solved, but it might need a lot of time and a lot of effort, but we'll see. But anyways, so usually that's pretty much the range. You don't really want to go any lower than 1.3 on the PLL. Some weird CPU might like 1.25, but usually the best spot on the most amount of Wolfdale CPUs, like E8400, E8500, E8600, the best PLL value is usually actually around 1.5. 1.45 to 1.5, something like this. But anyways, so the way I have done these PLL modifications is by using a voltage divider. I actually made this modification with the help of Terraraptor from Kazakhstan and Giggles from Germany. So I just chatted about this modification and the points with Terraraptor and Giggles. Thanks to Giggles for pointing me out the measurement point for the CPU PLL. But again, if you have the board viewer program and the correct file, you can find the spots yourself as well once you get the hang of it. But anyway, so I have already made the same modifications on the Rampage Extreme motherboards like over 4 years ago, almost 5 years ago. So I do have quite a lot of experience with this particular modification. But anyway, so we do this by using a voltage divider. So that's not your like traditional trimpot mod over there. That's like dividing one of the main motherboard voltages and manually feeding it to the CPU PLL voltage controller. So in my case, I'm taking the motherboard 3.3 volt rail that comes from the power supply from the 24 pin, and I'm manually dividing that voltage into the CPU PLL. You could use the 12 volt as well, but as you can imagine, 12 volts is very risky. You could accidentally supply 6 volts to your CPU, and that would of course damage the CPU. So that's why 3.3 volt rail is a lot safer, because technically some very old 65 nanometer CPUs could even survive 3.3 volts supplied to the CPU's PLL voltage rail. So that's why it's best to use the motherboard's 3.3 volt rail and not the 12 volt rail. But anyways, so the actual modding point is over there, just next to the first PCI Express X16 slot. As you can see, I accidentally burned the slot a little bit with a soldering iron, but anyways, so that's the LM324 chip. It's usually called either LM324 or, if I remember correctly, it's AS324, something like this. If you see that ball marking on the top right corner of the chip, as we are looking at the chip the upside down, so the incorrect way around. So you would have to turn the motherboard the other way around to read the texts on top of the chip. But anyway, so that's the pin number one. And the modding point is the pin number five, calculated from that spot over there. So the way it is done is that you need to lift that pin from the soldering pad where it has been attached by default. You need to lift it up from the motherboard's PCB and then solder onto that pin. So it's quite difficult if you are an amateur with soldering. So the easiest way to do that is to use a hot air soldering station. It's actually much easier to do that way than to use a manual soldering iron, trust me. So it's easiest if you just desolder the whole chip, turn the pin from the default orientation on your hands when it has been removed, so you can do it with your fingers, and then resolder it back onto its correct spot with the same hot air soldering station. And you can see I have put that electrical tape underneath the pin so I don't accidentally reconnect it to the solder pad when I solder onto that pin. Now that is just some very standard 1 amp wire. It's fine enough, it doesn't get any warm, so you don't need like huge, like very thick wire that would sustain a lot of amps. But anyways, so the first pin over there, or the first wire, so wire on the right is connected to the motherboard 3.3 volt spot. The middle one is connected to the modding point over there, and the left one is connected to any ground point. So it can be just any ground point. And when you start this for the first time, I recommend you set the variable resistor to 50/50. So it should be set 1.65 volts. So that means 3.3 divided by 2. And then you can turn the voltage up or down with this knob over here. These long knob VRs I actually bought from elmolabs.com. It's very hard to find these VRs that have a very long knob which you can control with your fingers and not with a flat-headed screwdriver. So I will post a link for these variable resistors from elmolabs.com in the description box of this video, so you can check them out if you wish. But it's actually quite easy in the end. So that's the modding point. You can use any ground point you wish. And here's the measurement spot. For measurement, you can use those tiny 3 or 4 digit measurement tools which you can solder onto the motherboard's points. But I still use a manual like multimeter. But you can do that whatever way you wish. So if you want to make the whole thing more compact, you can just use those 3 or 4 digit like LED voltmeters if you wish. You can buy those from elmolabs.com as well, and also from like eBay or AliExpress, whatever. And it's just connected to the to this cap over here. It should be this cap over here on the back side of the motherboard. I'll turn the board over right now to show you guys. And that's the motherboard or the other, or the back side of the board. The yellow wire is the measurement point, so this very same cap which I just pointed out for you guys. So it connects to the wire is connected to the positive side of the particular capacitor, and the 3.3 volt spot is over here. So this is the positive side of one of the 6.3 volt caps between the PCI Express slots. So the way you can find any of these 3.3 volt spots on the board is if you look, if you take a look at the 24 pin, like pinout or schematic, and look for the 3.3 volt wires. And then you can just take, if you suspect that some of the, especially the 6.3 volt caps on the board are possible 3.3 volt points on the board, you can test that by putting one of the multimeter leads onto the known 3.3 volt wires or pins over here, and then measure the resistance from one of those 3.3 volt pins to the positive side of the suspected capacitor. And that's the way I found that particular cap. So it's actually it's that particular cap over there. So that red one, that's the one I used. The wire is connected to the positive side of that particular capacitor over there. So it's actually pretty easy in the end, but that's the way I found the 20 or the 3.3 volt modding point. So now that's pretty much how it looks like. So this is actually the first board I did. I also did it on the better P5E3 after this, but you wanna practice on some disposable board first before you take the action on the very golden parts. That's what I mean. So if you have some very, very bad overclocking Rampage Extreme, P5E3 Premium, whatever board you wish to try, try it on some very bad one first before you do the same process on some very golden part, which is not easy to replace. And then just tighten down the wires and so on with something like hot glue so that they don't accidentally get detached while you are running the board. I've seen it happening and it's not fun when it happens. So just make sure that they don't slip off from the solder points. So that's what I mean. But now I will set the board on a test bench and just show you how it works so you can get some rough idea how do I control it. So let's turn on this board. And that's the CPU PLL voltage at the moment, 1.5, close to 1.5. That's not spinning because it's not connected, and it's posting American Megatrends. So sadly this board doesn't have BIOS measurement like Rampage Extreme, because this doesn't have the ROG chips that do the voltage measurements on Rampage Extreme, for example. So on Rampage Extreme you don't necessarily even need a voltage measurement, but it's very handy to have, because one other thing this thing does, so the PLL modification or the CPU PLL as a whole, it will affect your maximum cold boot temperature. So for example, if you can reach a colder temperature while the system is running at 1.4 volts on the PLL, it can make your cold boot bug, so the cold boot temperature, worse or warmer. So the key when you control, so let's actually press F1. So let's go to the BIOS. Quickly I'll check the temperature, because it's not, the fan is not even running, but there's thermal paste. So 31, so it's not that warm. I go to AI tweaker, but you cannot, like if you saw, you cannot measure, there's no CPU PLL voltage measurement on the P5E3 Premium. That's why you definitely need the hardware level thingy. So you can't even measure the PLL voltage on the AI tweaker, so down over here. So the key, so for example, you would like to, so for example, if you have the best cold boot temperature at 1.5 volts PLL, you want this voltage for the boot part, and immediately when you get the system running, you need to turn down the PLL like this, and you can then start pouring again and get colder, or get the CPU colder. Like for example, with my E8500, I'll try to demonstrate this. I get the CPU. So let's imagine the system has been turned off. I will raise the PLL to 1.5 range like this. I start the system, it starts running, and immediately turn down the PLL to like 1.4, like so. So that's how you control it. So, and when the PLL has been dropped to 1.4, 1.35 range, we can hit minus 170 again. So that's the idea, but this is very convenient actually. So I don't have to use a tiny screwdriver to control the PLL. So this is pretty much the way how we do this. It's very hard to, so if you look over here, CPU PLL voltage, minimum 1.5, 2.8 max. I think the range is a tiny bit larger on Rampage Extreme, but anyway, so that's pretty much how we want to do this. So once you have done this modification, you should never put any value anymore on the CPU PLL, so always leave it at auto. So let's shut down this machine. So it's very hard to show all of the steps on camera because I don't have like a very nice setup to film, but I'm sure you get the idea already based on this short coverage of the board that already has all of the modifications done. But you definitely want to use a physical measurement over here, and it never hurts to add some more like voltage measurements on the board because you don't have any display at the BIOS or software level on these old platforms.